Section 0 of the Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission. The Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission by Candido Rondon, translated by R.G. Reedy and Edwin Murray. Preface. The Journal du Commercio of Rio de Janeiro published the following notice on October 6, 1915. A manifestation of remarkable brilliancy, promoted in honor of Colonel Rondon by the Geographical Society of Rio de Janeiro, took place in the Phoenix Theater yesterday evening at 8:30. Beside the ceremony of the unveiling of his portrait, which is to be hung in the gallery of meritorious members of the Geographical Society, it was known that Colonel Rondon would avail himself of this opportunity to give, at the request of this institution, his first lecture on the Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the exploration of the River Duvida. The place first chosen for these lectures was the San Pedro Theater, but through unforeseen circumstances, the committee was obliged to alter this arrangement in 24 hours, and in this short space of time, the Phoenix Theater was prepared for this purpose. Long before the appointed hour, the guests commenced to arrive, and at 8:30 p.m., the elegant theater was quite full. Boxes, stalls, galleries, and all seats were taken. In the corridor, which encircles the stalls, one could see many people standing. The invitations had been distributed in accordance with the largest seating room of the San Pedro Theater, and for this reason there was some difficulty in seating all the guests in the Phoenix Theater. The first tier of boxes were all reserved for the President of the Republic, Vice President of the Republic, ministers, members of Congress, the diplomatic corps, and the government of the city of Rio de Janeiro. Amongst those presents, we took note of the following: the Minister of Marine, the Minister of Agriculture, the Vice President of the Senate, the Chief of Police, the American Ambassador, in whose box the American ensign was displayed, a commission of the Municipal Council, the Chief of the General Staff of the Army, and representatives of the President of the Republic and of the Ministers of Foreign Affairs, Justice, and War. Shortly before 9 p.m., the session was opened with General Gregorio Thaumaturgo G. Azevedo in the chair. At the table, placed on the stage, were also seated Colonel Rondon, Dr. Jose Boito, Alvaro Belford, and Sebastião Sampaio, members of the board of the Geographical Society, and Lieutenant Alfredo Severo dos Santos Pereira, who was committed to greet Colonel Rondon on behalf of the officers of the Army. The unveiling of Colonel Rondon's portrait was followed by prolonged cheers, after which General Thaumaturgo G. Azevedo delivered the following speech. The Geographical Society of Rio de Janeiro, which I have the honor of presiding, has decided to hold this great meeting in order to unveil the portrait of an illustrious Brazilian and honored member of the society, in acknowledgement of the relevant services rendered by him to the nation. In retribution of this proof of kindness, and at the request of the board of the society, the intrepid explorer will deliver three lectures on the subject of the geographical and other work carried out under his direction as chief of the commission of the telegraph and strategic lines of Mato Grosso, and also during the Roosevelt expedition. From these words, it can be easily gathered that I refer to the meritorious Colonel of Engineers, Candido Mariano Rondon, who is here present. His contemporaries of the military school say that whilst a student of this academy, Rondon had the constant ideal of connecting up all the important places of his native state by a system of telegraph lines. This preoccupation, which was always before his mind, he carried out beyond his wishes, for he has not only made this connection, but extended same to another state as great and as rich as his own, viz. The Amazon, and from there to the whole of Brazil by means of the already existing communications. It is close on 25 years since he undertook this work in the wilds of Mato Grosso, firstly as assistant, and afterwards as the chief, and he not only planned and studied these aerial lines, but traversed century-old forests, followed up in the courses of unknown rivers, exploring some and rectifying others, determining geographical positions and collecting abundant natural history material, heretofore unknown. This arduous task can only be understood by those who have carried out such work in other regions, such as the boundaries commissions, equally dangerous and full of sacrifice. Hence the value we give it by our own experience. In the same way, Rondon has rendered this patriotic service at the cost of his health, the risk of his life, and as a duty to his country. Of all these qualities, however, the one which most ennobles his name is the kindness which he initiated the service of the protection of the Indians, liberating them from the massacres of other tribes and even of civilized people in search of rubber, bringing them into the midst of civilization. This is his most meritorious work. For such deeds, the Geographical Society of Rio de Janeiro, in unveiling his portrait here, will be proud of having same among those hung in the members' gallery of the society. General Thaumaturgo's last words were received with prolonged cheers. At this point, Mr. Sebastián Sampaio, the official speaker of the society, recited the verses from Olavio Bilac's poem entitled O Caçador de Esmeraldas, The Hunter of Emeralds. Behold, sir, it was a wild wander, says the poet, and it was a lost march. It was but a selfish dream, that of this hunter of emeralds. Nevertheless, he has these verses to immortalize him. You never could have imagined the praise of this unique poet. The cherished symbol of our country could ever be yours. Bring, meanwhile, to the present era of civilization that company of pioneers. Substitute the wild wander and the lost march by the sure route which breaks through the wilderness, just as your pencil designed a map. Change that selfishness, the delirium of the green stones, into your unselfishness, into your earnest hope of causing the generous blood of life to circulate in all the arteries of our nation. Forget for a moment that we are referring to you, and I can affirm that you will be possessed with the vision of this moment in which I am greeting you with Bilac's poem, dedicated to Fernão Dias Pais Leme, who appears returning from the wilderness, like the ancient heroes, bringing the wilds on their shoulders. You will therefore see that it is perfectly useless for me to attempt to honor you with my own phrases. They fall to your feet like the forest flowers which drop slowly across your way through the silent woods of dark nights, trying in vain to fathom the incomparable brilliancy of your glory. Our society was desirous of having your picture. It has therefore procured one in retribution of its enormous debt, not towards you who do not require words of praise, but to our mother country, proud of your work and of your merit. I would that the words of our illustrious chairman, who is also full of services to the nation, should have sufficed for the ceremony. But I must comply with the rules of my office and delay somewhat the anxiously awaited narrative of your deeds. Far from me to attempt to eulogize this Homeric enterprise of 25 years, to repeat in simple words the magnificent work which you have accomplished would be to diminish it. We are all aware of the height to which fame attained. In history's altar has no steps for human aspirations. It is immortality that takes under her wings and carries the chosen souls. I prefer to admire you from below with the earnestness of all your admirers. Behold, all of us are the believers in the utility of your work. Your generation, which you highly honor, my own generation, which learns from your example. Your example as a youth, dreamer of a great dream, you are able to accomplish it at manhood, and by this you have taught us not only to esteem work, but to yearn for the ideal, which is so wanting in our days, materializing the present and threatening future. Your tenacity, the incomparable virtue of your tenacity, the constant fever which burnt in your mind through cold nights and that did not hamper your heroism, exposing your life like the genial poet in the stormy waters of the Amazon, for the sake of your work, this other poem, the poem of your journey, the new Lusiadas, of the new glories of our race. Your love, it was through this love that you substituted the soldiers of the old pioneers by brotherly affection. You have brought us with the unknown land and unknown brother, thus redeeming a race which science had condemned in its cruel mistake that it was sufficient to think without feeling. Why mention your services rendered? Who is there that ignores that you have given us this huge tract of unknown Brazil, which five heroes had previously attempted in vain to reach, and which you have finally incorporated into the nation by its giant's march from Mato Grosso to the Amazon? Why more words? You know the modest home of your studies and investigations, the Geographical Society where the bust of Gil Branco presides, the venerable statesman who gave us a new independence by erecting the defensive walls of the borders of the nation. You have completed the work of Gil Branco. You have discovered this unknown Brazil which he delimited. It was but natural that your picture should complete the external veneration in our humble temple. We have accomplished our duty. We are content. And our country, who hails you, gladly blesses you at this moment when we celebrate your glorious work. On terminating his speech, Mr. Sebastião Sampaio was received by the auditorium with loud and prolonged applause. First Lieutenant Severo dos Santos then delivered the following speech. Colonel Rondon, your comrades joyously associate in the just homage which you receive from the Geographical Society of Rio de Janeiro, the legitimate interpreter of the gratitude which the country owes to the fearless discoverer of the wilds of Brazil and to the humanitarian pacificator of our aborigines. And their pleasure in so doing is so much the greater, inasmuch as these words of praise fall on a group of devoted comrades of the glorious 5th Battalion of Engineers of the Strategic Telegraph Lines Commission from Mato Grosso to the Amazon, and of the service of the protection of Indians and localization of national laborers, which under your direction work so patriotically. You have once again shown what services military engineering is apt to render in times of peace, for since the time of the Romans it develops industry, that is to say, the real and useful effort of mankind over its surroundings. In view of the fact that your mission is rather of protecting human life than destroying it, as was the wish of a Lázaro Cárdenas or a Vauban. And during this long campaign, how many simple and obscure soldiers have silently fallen, unknown to the outside world? How many comrades of ours have courageously sacrificed themselves to their work since that kind-hearted and noble First Lieutenant Francisco Bueno Huerta Barbosa to the more recent one, fallen yesterday, wounded with many arrows, that good and brave Francisco Marques de Sousa, in whose diary, brought up to the last days of his life, we can read the narrative of the privations, hardships, and suffering of his epic exploration of the River Ananas. Only the active courage, the combative faith, and the potential energy of a chief like you could bring about the amalgamation of such manly souls in the crucible of a similar devotion, implanting in the hearts of the younger generation who followed you this intense passion for the unselfish and dangerous life of a forest traveler, that attraction for the unknown, that same faith in a high ideal, which, after facing all sorts of setbacks, has conquered and brought to a meritorious end the enterprise which we now honor and thank. Condemned to the primitive life of hunting and fishing, descending the rivers in canoes made from the trunks of trees, marching knee-deep in the marshes and swamps, or entangled in the vegetation, what enormous courage and energy is it necessary for a man to show in order to avoid succumbing in the struggle against hostile elements? There the marches are conducted amidst the dangers of the flora and the fauna, now crossing adust plateau, now forcing a way across the hispid woods, now again investigating the secrets of the treacherous waters, closed to view by the labyrinth of the branches between banks permeated with malaria. Pascal said that rivers are roads that travel, but here in our complicated potomographic system, a network of igapos and paranas, of falls and rapids, tombos and sumiduros, the river is more like a dangerous serpent, now winding insidiously between banks of mud, and suddenly throwing itself into the treacherous revolution of the agitated waters. And there is wrecked the capsized Uba, and the result of many months' work, instruments and provisions parsimoniously calculated for the rest of the voyage are lost. Then it is hunger that arises, with its long despair and the sadness of gulleting in corrupt and putrid meat, the spice and sauce with which the valiant eat. From the Lusiadas. Thanks to your wise foresight, along the track open for the main telegraph line, notes were mapped with the new geographical and ethnographical corrections with regard to the habit and customs of our native tribes, enriching our folklore and our knowledge with new information with regard to the flora, the land, and the aquatic fauna, and also with regard to the geological structure of our soil. The immortal journey across our hinterland, from the Parasi Plateau to the marshlands of the Madeira, will remain as if grooved in the surface of the earth which we inhabit, wedged in between meridians and parallels, which likewise mark out an immense region of suffering and heroism. For this reason, your name will be worthy in fame's memorials to remain. From the Lusiadas. As illustrious names with deathless laurels crowned, while time rolls on in every clime renowned. Again from the Lusiadas. Nevertheless, you did not enter into the mists of our forest with sword unsheathed, holding in the other hand the lighted torch of Bellona. On the contrary, you had before your eyes that gospel, as it were, of the woods, described by the great José Bonifacio, wherein it is said that we owe the Indians much kindness, constancy, and endurance, which we must show them as Christian usurpers, which we actually are, and that consequently we must not treat them with fire and sword, but rather first know them and what they are, and what by nature they must needs be, wild Indians, and then find out the means of converting them into what it is our duty to see they should be. At that time, this great statesman, who was the father of our national independence, had foreseen that to attempt ex abrupto to transform an Indian into a civilized being was the same as to attempt by force to turn from one day to another a child into an adult, thus violating all the laws of biology and sociology which govern the normal development of the human species. Already Father Nobrega had declared that with music and harmonious voices he would venture to bring him all the tribes of America. Nevertheless, even in our days, these Indians found themselves outside the law, which, like an inhuman stepmother, existed only for the purpose of delivering them up, defenseless to the iniquity of their persecutors, thus living like so many wild animals held at bay by the relentless hatred of the Indian hunters. There was even a scientist who proclaimed that the only natural solution of the problem was the extermination of our poor forest brethren. In the midst of such cruel injustice which dishonored our history, it fell upon your great heart and your civic courage to have the glory of taking up the tradition of Jose Bonifacio, saving from complete annihilation what remained of the unfortunate Aborigines population, bravely facing not only their unconscious arrows, but also the still more poisoned arrows of the unemployed demolishers who trail their life at the corners of the Avenida, blowing off their ridiculous and wanton criticism. It is because in the midst of the stagnation caused by skepticism and discouragement occasioned by negative criticism, by the exercise of pure talk of the most sterile ventriloquence, you speak the unknown language of action with the courage to undertake, the prudence to continue, and the firmness to carry out to the end. Your mission was not, however, that of theological catechism, which endeavors to impose its faith on the Gentiles, nor that of pseudo-scientific materialism, which preaches the monstrous theory of modern anthropophagy, according to which the strong and cultured may devour the weak and uncultured. No, your mission was inspired by scientific faith based on the unchangeable laws of positive sociology, which shows us the various people of the earth from the most primitive settlements or taba, or to the most enlightened society, as being fundamentally constituted of the same organic elements, differing only in the respective degree of development. This being the case, what we have to do is not to exterminate the Indian in the same way as one does not exterminate a child. One educates it, that is to say, we must lift him up to the level in which we live ourselves, peacefully and humanely placing within his reach the improvements of which we may dispose. Let us therefore admire your daring efforts and serene courage, the noble disinterestedness, thanks to which, whilst other nations supposed to be more enlightened were criminally hunting them down, we could prove to the Indian that we, the civilized people, are superior to them not in the superiority of our firearms, but in the greatness of our generosity and in the excellence of our altruism. Only those who see but the material and crude aspect of progress can deceive themselves, endeavoring to underrate the position which is due a nation in whose midst hatred against other races is unknown, and that brought about the abolition of slavery amidst rejoicing and flowers. Still more, therefore, than the profile of the unraveler of the wilds, what stands out most in our eyes, above all, are your service as the practical executor of the civilizing aspirations of Jose Bonifacio, and your great heart as a friend and protector of the persecuted Indian, whose lamentations ring out in the poem of Gonzalez Diaz, Tempiras. Your work stretches out into the future to an enormous extent, just as those sightings from our terrestrial telescope, which is daringly thrown up to the stars. Your name has already crossed our frontiers, proclaimed by such an eminent person as a Theodore Roosevelt in the centers of worldwide prestige. Gentlemen, he who most loves his country is he who served it more. Let us therefore learn in the noble life of this Bayard sans pour et sans epoche, in this courage of this clearer of virgin forest, in the intrepid action of this pioneer traveler of our interior. Let us learn from this character,
like a diamond without defects, in the naked and clean blade of this energy of steel, in the precious vein of this heart of gold, how to serve unfailingly, in disinterestedly, the land of our birth, our dear Brazil. After this speech, which was highly applauded by the assembly, Colonel Rondon rose to say a few words. Colonel Rondon rose from his seat on the right of the chairman of the society and ascended the tribune. The auditorium received the lecturer with loud cheers, which lasted for a few minutes. Then the illustrious Brazilian commenced his first lecture. Colonel Rondon was interrupted at various intervals during the lecture by the applause of the audience. Amidst the loudest applause, we may remember the projection on the screen of the pictures of the speaker with the Parsi children educated in the school instituted by Colonel Rondon among the tribe of those Indians, and who are now living in the city completing their education. Later on, they will return to the woods as telegraph operators. Colonel Rondon's last words were received with great enthusiasm. In proportion as Colonel Rondon proceeded with his lecture, projections were thrown onto the screen under the following headings: The President of the Republic, Dr. Lauro Müller, Colonel Roosevelt, Commemoração de Floriano, Confluence of the Pimenta Bueno and the G. Paraná, Lieutenant Jaguaribe, Captain Amilcar Botello de Magalhães, A Stretch of the Mouth of the River, Apa, Chamacoco Indians, Deck of the Riquelme, The Bolivian Frontier Mark, First Sight of the Corumbá, Chart of the Route, Adopted, On the Way to the Fazenda das Palmeiras, Marshland at the Fazenda das Palmeiras, Cattle Enclosures at the Fazenda das Palmeiras, The Cattle of the Fazenda, On the Way to a Hunt, The First Jaguar, Skin of the First Jaguar, The Second Jaguar, of which Rondon shows the head, Banks of the Paraguay, Swampy Pipiresol, Carandazao, Steamship Mato Grosso, View of the Fazenda de São João, Photograph of the setting out to a hunting expedition, Roosevelt laying down reading, Stretch of the River Nanarasu, Gaiva Bay, Camping at Porto do Campo, Setting out for a hunt at Porto do Campo, The result of the hunt, Porto do Campo, Departure for Tapirapuã, Arrival at Tapirapuã, Departure for Salto, Arrival at Salto, Breakfasting on a Hide, Aldeia Queimada, Entrance into the Track of the Telegraph Line, Rio Sacre, Camping at the Sacre, Salto Belo, A Parasi Village, The Interior of a Parasi Hut, A Parasi Mother, Parasi Basket, Game of Headball, Breakfast at Salto Belo, Yutiariti Village and Station, Yutiariti Waterfall, Group Close to the Yutiariti Falls, Juruena Station, Group of Nambicaras, A Nambicara Mother, Presents for the Nambicaras, A Tree in the Field, Serra do Norte. After a small interval, the cinematographic films of the expedition, divided into four parts, completed the program of the entertainment. The following is a list of the principal pictures taken in the wilds by Second Lieutenant Thomas Hayes. The Docket, Buenos Aires, Rio Paraná, Rosario, Asunción, Brazilian Frontier with Paraguay, The Carandá Palms, Porto Mortinho, Corumbá, expedition leaving for the first hunt on the River Tecari. The River Tecari, with its birds, waterfowl, and caiman. Colonel Roosevelt firing on a caiman. Porto de Hechiro. The expedition leaving for a hunt on the Fazenda das Palmeiras. At the Fazenda das Palmeiras, Colonel Roosevelt presents the skin of the first jaguar. Journey on the River São Lourenço and hunting on the same river. Marshlands on the River Paraguay and the Gaiva Lake. In Caceras, afterwards at Porto do Campo. Camp at Porto do Campo. Crossing the rivers on horseback. Ascent of the River Sebotuba in launches. Falls of the Sebotuba. Arrival at the port of Tapirapuã. Presentation of the members of the expedition. Colonel Roosevelt, Colonel Rondon, and the other members of the committee. Animals for use of the members of the expedition on their voyage. The determination of the coordinates of the port of Tapirapuã by Colonel Rondon and Lieutenant Lyra. Preparing the expedition to climb the Parasi mountain range. The journey across the prairies of Tapirapuã. The port of Salto and the journey to Aldea Queimada. End of section.
Section 1 of the Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission. The Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission by Candido Rondon. Translated by R. G. Reedy and Edwin Murray. First Lecture, Introduction. Some time ago, friends of mine informed me that the Rio de Janeiro Geographical Society, desiring to manifest the high degree in which they held the modest contribution brought by my work in the wilds toward the development of the descriptive study of the lands and people of Brazil, had resolved to bestow on me the distinguished honor of having my picture hung amidst the select company of those of our compatriots who have most distinguished themselves by their services rendered to Brazil in this branch of human accomplishments. This resolution was so out of proportion between the small value of the results directly attributable to the capacity of my own individual efforts and the magnitude of the distinction with which it was proposed to reward them that I at once felt it my duty to request the distinguished society to reconsider their decision, and after weighing all the facts which I myself would submit to them, come to a decision which more in accordance with the true nature of the facts would spare me the constraint of finding myself in the position of having to regret not accomplishing all that was expected of me, rather than flatter myself with the praise of that which I had effected. This reasoning, which I intended to submit to the Geographical Society, was, in my opinion, of itself so evidently convincing as to remove from this assembly all aspect of a festive or congratulatory solemnity. Were it not for the scarcity of time now at my disposal, and the still greater failing in the poor means of expressing myself, I would give you another reason which, at the present moment, holds my soul in mourning and my heart closed to all sentiment which has not the bitterness of the deepest pain. An enormous succession of unpardonable errors, because they were committed in our days when the doctrine of Auguste Comte is sufficiently propagated to render the sentiment of universal fraternity familiar to the most accomplished peoples of the West, has resulted in hurling the leading nations of humanity against one another, and has kept them for more than 1 year plunged in the floods of bloodshed, which snatch off, pick to pieces, and submerge the most delicate and beautiful qualities of our civilization, namely gentility to women, kindness to little children, the aged and the sick, and that sentiment of individual dignity which restrains one from committing violence against persons and things, lest one should diminish in one's own eyes the esteem and respect which is due to one's self-respect. Immersed in the sea of anguish which flows from the heart of humanity, the loving mother, who sees her children tearing themselves to pieces with the assistance of the very resources which she had created and given to them, prompted by the noble ambition of placing them above the sorry solicitings of private animality, I feel pained at the frailty of my strength which does not permit me to contribute toward the work of those who are using their efforts in the direction of mitigating the devastations of this horrible catastrophe, other than in accompanying them with expressions of my gratitude and in supplicating destiny to afford them the greatest facilities capable of enabling them to attain the object to which they have devoted themselves. Such weighty considerations, however, could only prevail were it a question of doing or of suppressing acts which affected my person directly and exclusively, but they could not be invoked in order to justify my non-compliance with any duties inherent to the exercise of the functions entrusted to me. Friends of mine, to whom I explained the scruples which oppressed me, and the constraint which I felt in assisting at the special honor of the inauguration of my own portrait, which they intended to hang in the gallery of a geographical society, confirmed the objection which I had already made to myself. That is, that all the attention evidently only seemed directed towards me individually, but that in reality it aimed further and embraced also the Telegraph Lines Commission, which the Republican governments, since the time of worthy President Penna, have used as an instrument to render the nation the services which are known to all. Considered from this and sole point of view, my presence at this meeting is more than justified. It is necessary, for I am doing nothing more at this moment than carrying out the duty of personally representing the Commission of the Telegraph Lines to come and tell you, Mr. President of the Geographical Society and your illustrious associates, how gratifying it is for the members of the Commission, taking individually and conjointly, to receive the support from the applause with which you reward the efforts which they, far off in the wilds of the country, have used their best endeavors to develop, with the only hope of contributing to the continuation of the work which we inherited from the past and are preparing for the future, to lift up our dear country to such a level as will enable it to give full expansion to its aspirations and to render to humanity the gifts which she has so lavishly spread around us. As for me, I must acknowledge that I rejoice at the circumstances with which destiny has entwined my life. Without referring to other sources of lasting happiness from which the most complete blessings flow, which may have fallen on me in my mother's breast, and without delaying in an infusion of renewed and daily increasing gratitude, and my indebtedness to the religion of humanity, which, taking me by the hand, conducts me with a firm step along the road of altruism, which is day by day smoother, easier, and more beautiful, the only certain and true aim of the unsurpassable pleasures of the devotion of high ideals aspiring the ennobling works of human nature, it is sufficient to record the facts that during the whole of my public career I have had the good fortune to see associated with my work as chiefs or assistants, citizens who honor the name of our nationality, colleagues who dignify the class to which they belong, and friends who raise friendship itself to its highest degree, making us discover therein new charms hitherto undiscerned. Under such conditions, the greatest blessing which could be vouchsafed to me evidently would be that the ties existing between these chiefs, assistants, and myself should still become closer and closer and everlasting, so that as long as the memory of any of us lasts, once invoked would immediately appear accompanied by the others. The hanging of the portrait of the chief of the Telegraph Lines Commission in the picture gallery of the Geographical Society of Rio de Janeiro satisfies at least, in part, the wish which I have just expressed, because at any future time he who looks at this portrait will at once recollect that its object is to call to mind the remembrance of those of my distinguished assistants and friends whose vigorous cooperation resulted in the success of the enterprise initiated in 1907, which was to open up and hand over to civilization a huge territory in our country, until that date in a wild and abandoned state. You can therefore realize, Mr. President of the Geographical Society, the nature, the extension, and the deepness of my gratitude for the kindness which you and your worthy co-associates have shown me, and for which I confess myself eternally and deeply indebted to all of you, not only collectively, but each one separately and individually. To all of you, I beg to tender the undying thanks of the members of the Commission of the Strategic Telegraph Lines from Mato Grosso to the Amazon, who promise to reciprocate the distinction which you deign to honor their modest but sincere past efforts with renewed and greater efforts in devoting themselves entirely to the love and to the work of augmenting the moral and material aggrandizement of our mother country. And you, my noble colleagues of the army, what do you expect me to say to you to express, even in the pallid and awkward fashion that I have just done to the worthy Geographical Society, a part, at least, of the emotion which I feel at seeing you here assembled to bring me, not simple words of encouragement, approval, and applause, but the most affectionate effusion of good and sound comradeship, which burst forth, grew and became more consolidated with the warmth of the communion of sentiments, the resolutions and the thoughts which constantly unite us around the ideal of the Republican aspirations of our country, represented by the colors, in the design, and in the words of our beautiful and adored national flag. You wished to take an active part in this assembly to signify to us that the campaign we have been for so long sustaining against the hardships and snares of the wilds has not broken the solidarity between you and your colleagues of the Commission of the Telegraph Lines. On the contrary, it has strengthened it. This unity of purpose never had any other origin or motive beyond the desire, or, I should say, ambition, of thoroughly understanding the sentiment and the sense of our duties to the nation which only aspires to become great by peaceful labor and international fraternity. Your manifestation is joyously accepted by your comrades of the telegraph lines, who feel happy at seeing how completely you reciprocate the truly fraternal affection which they also devoted to you. In their name, and in my own, I beg of you to accept a cordial shake hands and our best thanks for the comfort which you have brought us in accepting as yours, and therefore is that of our class, the work and efforts which we have accomplished in the wilds and on the boundaries of the country as obedient servants of our government and country. End of Section 1. Section 2 of the Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission. The Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission by Candido Rondon. Translated by R. G. Reedy and Edward Murray. First Lecture, Part 1. Origin of the Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition. Organization of the Brazilian Commission. Choice of routes submitted to Mr. Roosevelt. Selection of the one relative to the Rio da Duvida. Overland journey of the chief of the Brazilian Commission from Rio de Janeiro to the mouth of the River Apa. The heads of the Brazilian and American commissions meet on board the Paraguayan gunboat Riquelme. Formation of the Roosevelt-Rondon Commission. On the 4th of October, 1913, I arrived at the Barro del Macaco station, having come from Barro de Burgos, the extreme southern point of the telegraph lines from Mato Grosso to the Amazon, which I had just inspected, when I received from Dr. Lauro Müller, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, a telegram inviting me to accompany the ex-president of the United States of America, Colonel Theodore Roosevelt, on a journey which he proposed to undertake through the interior of Brazil as far as Venezuela. I replied accepting this honorable commission, and on the same day left bound for the river Comemoracro de Floriano, which I descended, making use of the means of transport created by the Telegraph Lines Commission. I entered the river Pimenta Bueno, and afterwards the Guaiparana, at the mouth of which I found the scout Cidade de Manaus, which took me to the capital of the state of Amazonas. Considering the urgency which existed to provide for the organization of the indispensable elements for the journey of the expedition, I immediately took steps which would be useful, whichever might eventually be the final route chosen by the eminent American statesman, to get out of the central Brazilian Cordillera into the Amazon basin. Of all the routes which might be followed, that which appeared to me preferable was one afforded by the courses of the river Arinos, Juranena, Papagaio, and Duvida. For this reason I ordered canoes to be prepared on the banks of each of these four rivers, at points of easy access, for travelers who might penetrate into the highlands of the Parecis, coming from the headwaters of the river Paraguay. During my voyage to Manaus, I received word that Colonel Roosevelt's project was to enter the river Amazon by the Tapojos and into this river by the Arinos. But evidently this course could not offer anything new to an expedition whose object was to unravel the unknown aspects of our wilds. I decided, therefore, to submit to the appreciation of our illustrious guest other routes, which could with more advantage be taken by his party, and I therefore telegraphed from Manaus to Rio de Janeiro to the chief of the drawing section of the Telegraph Commission, First Lieutenant Jaguaribe de Matos, to show him at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs the geographical charts drawn in our technical office, with the data supplied by our explorations, suggesting the following routes. A. From São Luís to Caceres, or from Coaba, along the Telegraph Lines Commission Road as far as the Barro do Macaco station, and there to embark in barges to descend the rivers Comemoracro de Floriano, Guiparana, and the Madeira. B. Follow the same route as far as José Bonifacio station, one station before Barro do Macaco, and thence gaining the Paso de Lina on the Duvida, to descend and explore this river, which would probably take the party to Madeira. C. reached the Tapajos by descending the Joruena, and not the Arinos, which latter route has been known for a century, so much so that it has served as a trading route for some time between Para and Mato Grosso. D. From San Luis to Caceres, passed to the valley of Guapore, and from the city of Mato Grosso to descend this river and the Mamore in a launch as far as the falls of the Guajira Mirim, here to take the Madeira-Mamore railway to get to the city of Santo Antonio do Madeira. E. Finally, by the telegraph line road to reach the River Papagayo at Utiarity Station, and by this river enter the Tabajas. Of these five alternatives, the one which offered the greatest unforeseen difficulties was that relative to the River Duvida. This was the one chosen by Mr. Roosevelt. During my voyage from Manaus to Rio de Janeiro, where I arrived on the 11th of November, I organized the staff of the Brazilian Commission and picked out the professional men who might be entrusted, for the greatest benefit of the nation, with the services of astronomy, determination of the geographical coordinates, topography, botany, zoology, and geology, besides those relative to general administration. Of these devoted assistants, those who were in Rio de Janeiro left in parties successively from the 22nd of November to the 5th of December for Montevideo in order to ascend the River Paraguay, and from there make for Corumba and other points, where they were to await the arrival of the expedition and organize the services entrusted to them. As for myself, obligated to remain in Rio de Janeiro to attend to the requirements of the indispensable equipment necessary to the success of the commission which was confided to me, I would follow on by land as late as possible, but still in time to descend the Paraguay and await the entry of Mr. Roosevelt into Brazilian territory. To accompany me on this journey, I retained Captain Amilcar de Magalhães and Dr. Eusebio de Oliveira, the former my assistant and the latter the geologist of the expedition. All baggage was sent on by water via Montevideo. On the 28th of November, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs communicated to me that Mr. Roosevelt would leave Buenos Aires for Asunción on the 4th or 5th of December, and 3 days afterwards would continue to ascend the River Paraguay, making for Corumba. On receipt of this advice, I left Rio de Janeiro for Sao Paulo by the night train on the 2nd of December, having previously taken the necessary precautions to enable us to travel, without interruption, on the following railways: Central of Brazil, Sorocabana, Noroeste, and Itapura to Corumba. On the evening of the 5th, we arrived at the end of the line of the Itapura-Corumba Railway, the construction of which went a little beyond Rio Verde, and even so, a few kilometers of this line were not yet consolidated and could only be used for ballast train. Here we organized our march on horseback to reach the end of the line which was being constructed from Porto Esperanca to Itapura. We thus traveled 168 kilometers as far as Campo Grande, where we arrived at 6 a.m. on the 9th. 3 hours later, we left Campo Grande in a special train, which took us to Porto Esperanca, situated 2,248 kilometers from Rio de Janeiro, and where we alighted at 11 p.m. We immediately embarked on the steamer Nyoac, belonging to the Lloyd Brasileiro, which, by order of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, awaited us under steam. Before dawn on the morning of the 10th, we were under way. A little before 1 o'clock on the afternoon of the 11th, we anchored in front of the mouth of the River Apa, where we were to await the arrival of Mr. Roosevelt and his party. From the point where we lay at anchor, the River Paraguay extends its course downstream in one long straight line, forming one of those stretches which, in the picturesque language of the dwellers on riverbanks, is called Estirado. We knew that the American expedition had left Asunción on the 8th, on board the Paraguayan gunboat Adolfo Requielmi. Therefore, barring accidents on the two shallows which hamper navigation on this river, a little before and above the city of Concepcion, it could now not be long before the anxiously awaited moment of sighting our future guests would arrive. In this expectation, we gazed in the direction whence they should come, full of anxiety to catch sight of some smoke or other sign which would predict the meeting of the Paraguayan boat to us. At the end of 2 hours, we discerned the outline of a steamer coming up at full speed. We hastened to make the last arrangements for the reception which we thought would presently take place. On the deck of the Nyoac, already in white uniform, which had been chosen for this occasion, we did not lose sight of the small vessel, which, like a new Proteus, constantly appeared to us to be changing its shape, sometimes confirming our hopes, sometimes dissuading us. At last we ascertained that this was not the long-desired Requielmi, but a tug carrying Chamococo Indians, who were going to some industrial establishment on the banks of the River Paraguay, and were there to continue their sad and laborious life, semi-enslaved to some company of strangers, who had converted their free forests into an unhomely, hard, and unfilling country. In this way we passed the day and the night of the 11th of December. On the following morning we were at our posts scanning the horizon towards Asuncion. The hours slipped away slowly until 10 o'clock, and were running on their fatal march, when we were suddenly delighted to see, at the end of the Estorado, a ship. We soon distinguished its flag, at the stern masthead, and at the same we saw that it was the Paraguayan gunboat. At 11:30 a.m., the Requilelme was alongside the Nyoac, and from its quarter-deck Mr. Roosevelt corresponded to our waving in anticipation of the greetings which we were about to bring to him on board, together with the offers of cordial hospitality which the government of my country had entrusted me to make. The Paraguayan anchor had hardly grappled the bottom of the river when my assistants and I made for the ship, on whose deck was to take place the ceremony of the introductions, between a statesman accustomed to the usages of European diplomacy and the man who for almost 25 years had lived in the wilderness, frequenting the ministries of the Boraro, Parichi, and the Nambuquerera Indians, perfecting himself in the etiquette of their respective courts. Withal, I was not tormented with nervousness at the outset, because the mass of exterior circumstances, which forms the circles in which we have to act, support and help us to find the necessary gestures adequate to the moment which we traverse. And if, when we greet in the Bororo fashion, we are immediately prepared for the sharp odor of naked bodies painted with aurukum, in compensation, when we exchange amiabilities in the language of Corneille and Molière, we are insensibly drawn to gentleness and refinement, and without any effort, the charming manners which are peculiar to the life of our drawing-rooms come back to us. I now found myself on the deck of the Paraguayan warship, greeting Mr. Roosevelt in the name of the Brazilian government, repeating to him the offer of our hospitality, and introducing to him the members of the Brazilian Commission, who from that moment remained at his orders. Mr. Roosevelt replied to our words, not only with the distinction characteristic of his great intellect and high culture, but also with the affability of a true friend of our country and its people. It was the intention of the Brazilian government that we should take the American Commission on board the Nyoac there at the mouth of the River Apa, but when we alluded to this part of our program, we saw that the Paraguayan officers would be very disappointed if they were deprived of the honor of taking the ex-president of the United States of America to Corumba. As we all of us had the same object in view, which was to render homage to our guest, I gave way to the Paraguayans, and was glad that destiny had been so benevolent as to allow me the privilege, on the first occasion that I found myself in an official capacity in that country, of expressing my sentiments of fraternity to the most genuinely American nation of all those who have formed themselves in these lands of Columbus. Having settled this point, a little after midday, the Requilelme continued to ascend the river in the direction of Brazil, and the Nyoac followed her closely as an escort. We journeyed in this way until 2 o'clock in the afternoon, when both ships stopped in order that Mr. Roosevelt might come on board the Nyoac to return the visit we had made to him. Besides the courtesies which were exchanged between Brazilians and Americans, it was also agreed that Mr. Roosevelt, on the day following his arrival at Corumba, would leave for the Fazenda das Palmeiras on the River Tanqueray, where he would have his first jaguar shooting. From this ranch, he would go on to the one called Ferme, for the same purpose, namely killing jaguars. From Ferme, he would return to Corumba to enter the River Cuyaba at the point where the Fazenda de São Raul is situated, and in which the president of the state of Mato Grosso, Dr. Costa Marques, was awaiting him, and would also offer our guest a jaguar, peccary, and tapir hunt, besides a roundup, rodeiro, of 6,000 head of cattle on the open plains. He would return afterwards to the River Paraguay to take the San Luis de Sacares route, visiting on the way the Fazenda de Descovado. From San Luis de Sacares, he would continue the journey, on the next day, to Tapirapoan, in case he decided not to hunt on the River Juaru. On the road to Tapirapoan, he might do some shooting on the Fazenda Barranco, at the Porta do Campo, and at the farm called Palmito. Finally, from Tapirapoan, he would journey on horseback across the Parichi Plateau as far as the River Duvida, which he and I and a part of the two commissions would descend in a canoe, whilst the other party would go as far as the Guiparana in which they would embark, directing themselves towards the Madeira and Manaus, at which place all should finally meet. We arrived at Porto Mitenhall, where we dropped anchor and went on board the Paraguayan gunboat to take part in a dinner offered by Mr. Roosevelt to the Brazilian Commission. On the following day, we gave a breakfast on board the Nyok in honor of the officers of the Requielme. On the 14th, we were opposite the legendary fort of Coimbra. Mr. Roosevelt did not visit this fort, neither did he see the famous Gruta del Inferno, Grotto of Hell, because he considered that the time which he had at his disposal to absent himself from his country was almost insufficient to carry out the program previously laid out. At 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we had passed the Bolivian frontier mark on the right bank of the River Paraguay, and only 24 hours afterwards did we sight the city of Corumba, in which port the Requielme entered, escorted by a large number of small craft full of ladies and gentlemen who had come to greet our honored guest. While still on board the Requielme, Mr. Roosevelt received the compliments of the commander of the Brazilian fleet of warships on the River Paraguay, represented by a first lieutenant of our navy, and on shore he was received by the commander and officers of the 13th Military District, the Municipal Council, the federal and state authorities, and by the whole population of the city, who were most enthusiastic in manifesting their delight at having the eminent American statesman amongst them. End of section 2.
Section 3 of the Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission. The Roosevelt-Rondon Scientific Expedition and the Telegraph Line Commission by Candido Rondon. Translated by R.G. Ridey and Edwin Murray. First Lecture, Part 2. On the morning of the 16th, the Brazilian Commission gave a farewell breakfast to the officers of the Paraguayan gumboat in which Mr. Roosevelt and the members of the American Commission participated. The toast of honor was raised to the Paraguayan Republic, which, won again in common brotherhood, took such brilliant part in the honors bestowed upon the statesman, who of all brothers in present day represents the policy of American fraternity. That day we remained in Corumba, verifying the baggage of the American Commission and examining the convenient propriety of certain articles which they had intended to be used in the wilds. But on the following morning, having presented myself to Mr. Roosevelt ready to embark whenever he wished, we took the Noyac and left for the Teraguay, a river which enters the River Paraguay by various branches, one of which is called Rio Sino. It is on this branch that the landing stage of the Farinza des Palomares is, and we directed our course to it. But before arriving there at 5:30 p.m., we sighted a giant anteater, Terremuda bandeira, which, with its clumsy gait and small jumps, was wandering in the camp. This was one of the specimens of our fauna, which Mr. Roosevelt desired to obtain for the zoological collection of the Natural History Museum of New York. I ordered the ships to stop, and we jumped on shore, the dogs running ahead to embarrass the flight of curious quadruped Kermit. Dr. Soledad and I completed the circle, and Mr. Roosevelt fired his Springfield gun, the type used in the North American Army, of great precision and admirable penetration. The beast dropped, and we, delighted by this fortune commencement of our guest hunting expedition, congratulated him. He thanked us with great satisfaction, which was fully justified, moreover.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.